Hello and welcome, ladies and gentlemen, gamers of all shapes and sizes. Okay, we're about to begin another Let's Play of Civilization 5 and Brave New World, of course, and we're gonna try another bunch of mods here. Last time I played Tartessos, which is a nation in Spain, and a very ancient kingdom in Spain, and they were part of the ancient Mediterranean civilizations pack right here, Brave New World. But this time we're gonna try something a little bit different, a little bit too extreme, and we're gonna try something called the Ice Age game. And basically we're gonna combine as many Ice Age nations that gain bonuses from snow as possible. Now, before I begin with this, I just want to remind you that, don't worry, I will be coming back to Endless Legend, and in fact, I'm going to be working on two Let's Plays at the same time. This, Civ 5, the Ice Age game, and Endless Legend at the same time. So, of course, it does mean that updates are going to be a little bit slow, but the end result is going to be just fantastic. It's going to be really cool. I would, you know, use ideas from here and there. And, of course, this will give you a little more experience to, so that one day I might actually try a multiplayer mod game for Civ 5 as well. Now, first things first, I just want to describe the mods to you. I'm actually gonna post the links to these mods below in the description, so if you want to download them and try them for yourself, you're free to try them. First of all, here's the Inuit. These are the ones I'm gonna play for. These are the ones that I'm actually gonna take control of. The Inuit, of course, are the people who you know, they're more commonly known as the Eskimo, but that's, I'm not sure if that's an offensive term to use for them, but, or not. But I think Inuit is overall the more accurate term to use, and we're gonna read more about them in the Civilopedia eventually. All right, so we're gonna be playing as these, and there's the. A couple of civilization sets. This one is not really important. Nepal, I suppose, are cool because they gain bonuses from, I think, in Nepal and Durrani, they gain bonuses from mountains and such. So it might be interesting to play them as well. Then there's the Civ Advanced. This one is really cool because it gives you a bunch of new luxury resources, a bunch of new bonus resources, as well as a lot of really cool improvements that are going to help you in the early game, which are actually very important for us, especially for us, because we're going to be playing as a snow people. We have a starting bias in snow and ice and coast, so we're going to have a very small amount of luxury resources, so we absolutely need this. It's going to be very it's also going to make the game much more interesting. And of course the ice boats, which will allow work boats to cross ice tiles, and this is a very important thing because and in fact, the guy who made this mod, he says that it often annoys me to settle near a civ near a city, a receive resource, and not be able to reach it. I'm pretty sure you've seen it happen when a certain resource is completely surrounded by ice and nobody can reach it except submarines. And I think it's reasonable that ice boats should be, these work boats should be allowed to reach that, and only these work boats. And so I added this mod as well. And then we have the Norway. You know, I just added a bunch of nations that gain bonuses from snow, tundra, and ice. And we have the Kingdom of Norway, the Khanate of Siberia, which is, a very old kingdom, a very old Khanate in modern Siberia. They're called the Khanate of Siberia. And then we have Montenegro. This one is not really important to the game, but for the snow thing, but you know, I've just added it for fun. Sami, Masters of the Tundra. They also have a starting bias in Tundra, and they gain a bunch of bonuses from Tundra. I think food and fighting or something like that. Yeah, they have a couple of bonuses, economic and military, from Tundra as well. The Seljuk Empire, I'm not going to add them this time around. The Elder Scrolls is really cool because it changes the names of some of the buildings and some of the resources, which makes them kind of funny and kind of cool, and very nostalgic for people who like to play Skyrim in particular. I'm pretty sure you can identify the names of some of the resources we're going to use, and this one in particular is really cool. In fact, I'm going to be using the Ysgrimor from the Skyrim nation. Yeah, there's a civ in one of these nations inside this pack. It's the nation of Skyrim. Yes, it's going to be an actual mod, and they also gain certain bonuses from snow and tundra, I believe, and they have a starting bias for tundra. And of course Finland, as we all know. I wanted to try the Ice Kingdom, but I felt they were not very well balanced. In fact, the AI doesn't really play very well with them, and they're a bit too cartoonish for my taste, so I decided to leave them out for now. And you know, I think, yeah, the Finnish, the Norwegian nations are way, way better. I prefer those. Yeah, did I add Norway? I think Norway is, yeah, there it is. This is Norway. Armenia is okay, but they kind of make the game a little bit lopsided because one of their abilities is to immediately adopt the religion of whoever founds the first religion. Yeah, so whoever makes the first religion, they will immediately adopt it. So it kind of makes the game a little bit lopsided. It would be nice for multiplayer, I suppose. You know, you and your friend, one of you takes Armenia. It would be really cool. In fact, I'm going to see if this one is yeah, this one is actually good for multiplayer. It's compatible with multiplayer, so it's excellent. Iceboat's also compatible multiplayer. So yeah, even though this one for the advanced buildings and strategic resource. All right, so overall this is a decent collection here. I'm gonna post the links in the description, of course, for those of you who want to try them. And yeah, so we're just gonna get loaded for now. Now it might get stuck a little bit. So yeah, I just got back from the loading screen. Sometimes when you're applying so many mods, you see here, especially on my computer and my laptop, it's a little bit slow. So it takes a little bit of time. It actually freezes a little bit during the loading, and that's what I've been. But anyways, I'm gonna edit out that freezing section there. And all right, so we have a huge selection here. Pearl of Pearls here, this guy is Ahmed Abdali. Yeah, they have a thing related to great writers. They have a lot of great writer bonuses. We're actually gonna add them because they gain bonuses from mountains and it makes them interesting to play against and with indeed. First of all, we're gonna go for the Inuit. There we go. Ikunik, I believe that's how he pronounced, and I'm gonna show you the units. They have really cool units, actually. By the way, the reason why I'm playing as them is because they're actually one of the most difficult nations to play as, and they have a starting bias on snow, coast, and ice, all three together. That's a very difficult bias to satisfy, and it usually gives you very broken starts. They're either too good or too bad. They're just sometimes you start with completely surrounded by ice and you can't settle, you can't even acquire, you know, the fish resources that are supposed to be transformed into seals and all this. So we're actually gonna play this and I'm gonna start the game multiple times until we get the perfect start. And yeah, I actually want to manually pick all the nations that I want them to participate. We're gonna pick Denmark, Sweden, and Russia because, you know, since we are playing as on a map that is going to be an ice age map, as you can see here, so there's going to be a lot of ice, a lot of snow. So I decided it was thematic to have a lot of nations that have to do with snow overall, and you know, cold regions, and you know, Russia, Sweden, Denmark, as well as Norway and Finland, they're all, you know, cold countries, and so it might be nice to add them. I suppose it would be thematic with this whole let's play. We're also gonna add, let's see here, there's Norway and Sweden. There we go, this is Norway. I'm just gonna take my time to add them there. Where is Norway and Finland? Finland is somewhere down here, I think. All right, so there's Finland, and right above them is Siberia. The nation of Siberia. We're gonna add the Sami all together, and let's see here. We already have Russia. We have the Sami of the Inuit, and finally we already have Norway, I believe. High Rock, Morwins, and elsewhere. This is actually the cat-like creatures, tiger creatures from the Elder Scrolls game. This is Siberia. There we go. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing this. And by the way, prepare yourself for a flurry of bad pronunciations. I'm going to be tripping over the pronunciations every now and then. It's going to be just hilarious. And, you know, so don't get too angry at me. Just if you have any corrections, you might want to suggest them in the comments. Okay, we're just going to check out. Yeah, oh, I wanted to add Nepal as well because I think they also have bonuses from some kind of... Where's Nepal? Can't see Nepal anywhere. This is the Netherlands, the Cyrodiil. So, all right, so we're going to add Argonia because they have this unique bonus from marshes. It's very rare to see a civ actually gain bonuses from marsh. So we're actually going to use that to draw it. But I can't find Nepal anywhere. Where they are? Where are they? I think this should be somewhere here. I will run into them again eventually. They will... Oh, there we go. There's Nepal. All right, so we have these nations here. It's a very fine collection. Now here's the thing, I started the game on Ice Age map multiple times and it's just very bad. The Ice Age map is not very good. It doesn't fulfill the start bias for me. So I actually tried a shuffle map instead and it works a lot better, or even better, the continents. Where's the continents? Yeah, continents. This one is amazing. It will start all of us on more or less the same continents, or it might start me on my own continent. So it's going to affect the gameplay, whether we go for liberty or tradition or such. So I'm actually going to try this, and I will reload multiple times until we get the perfect start. I usually go for disabled start bias because for some reason the Inuit, they have a very powerful starting bias that is not affected by this option here. But I'm actually going to leave it this time around. We'll see what we come across. So yeah, this is the lineup here. We have Norway, Denmark, Finland, the Sami, Sweden, Siberia, Skyrim, and Russia. All of these almost 10 out of these 12 nations, they all have starting bias on tundra or snow or, you know, indeed, coastal stuff, you know. And Nepal, of course, and Durrani, they have the starting bias for mountains. It's going to be a very interesting game. They're going to have a lot of variety. And, of course, they're going to have a lot of competition because they will more or less want to fight on the same type of terrain. But anyways, I'm actually going to try Ice Age just for the, you know, for argument's sake. Because it's thematic, you know, I just want to stick with the theme of playing on snow. So I think the only way for us to succeed with the Ice Age is to make sure we have the right start. And in order to have the right start, I think you need to have at least like 2 strategic resources and 3 fish, or maybe perhaps 1 luxury resource, 1 bonus resource, and 2 fish that are located next to ice, so that you can turn them into the unique luxury resource for the Inuit, which is, of course, seals. So yeah, we're going to jump right in. And, of course, the game is going to freeze a little bit here. I'm just going to have to edit this part out. You can listen to the dialogue if you want.
In a hostile land, we learn to master even the bleak winter landscape.
All right, so we've just begun here. I just want to check out, just to make sure, yeah. So you can see here, it's a very, it's a wasteland. There is absolutely nothing for us here. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to continue to restart the game until we get an ideal start, because this is just horrible. We need at least 2 or 3 fish around, or at least 1 luxury resource nearby. Hell, if there's like 3 or 4 bonus resources next to us, that would be excellent for me. I think that would satisfy my criteria, but this is just impossible. We're gonna have science problems, we're gonna have population problems, and not to mention production. Even though we can, yeah, science is actually very important, because you want to go for this here calendar. This is the one that will give you the ability to build. Where is it? Yeah, there it is. Build an Inuksuk. I think that's how you pronounce it. It gives you +1 culture and +1 food. You can only build it on snow and tundra tiles. And, I mean, you could improve it. It will... I will explain to you how it works, but basically it will really improve this area. But you need a lot of research to get there, which means you need a lot of population. So if you don't have enough fish and deer next to you, this is not a very good start. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to continue to restart until I get the ideal starting location. And I will edit that part out until we arrive at the perfect start. And hopefully we will continue to play that.
Yeah.
I just wanted to stop here. I was in the middle of cycling through the starting locations, and I came across this one. This one, it does look very tempting. You can actually turn these fish into seals, which is a luxury resource, very powerful. But look at this. This area is completely barren. There is no river. There is no mountain. Not even any tundra or anything. Usually, I start with deer next to me. So if this starts with 3 fish and 2 or 3 deer, it would have been perfect. I would have actually played that. But as it is, this one is not good enough. So I'm just going to continue rolling, and I will be back with you in a few minutes. Alright, finally, after hours of searching, we have found the near-perfect starting location. It's not really that brilliant, I mean, especially since we have these deers who are completely isolated in the snow, having only 1 food tile yield. But hopefully we can improve them with our unique improvement, and I will show it to you shortly. First of all, we're going to begin with founding the city. Now, you will notice that our food income at the start is not the best, and we have not nearly enough production to produce too much units here, but we're gonna start with the cheapest, which is the Unak. Now I want to just describe to you what exactly this thing does. This is the unique unit of the Inuit, and they have double movement on snow. They can move like 4 tiles on the snow. And another thing they can do, they can embark on the water right from the start. They can embark on the coastal tiles from the beginning of the game. They are a ranged unit. They can attack at range, at a range of 1 tile, just like the Gatling gun. And finally, if they enter the water, they can actually improve sea resources. They can improve these, the mud crabs here, the fish. And yeah, here's the thing, the mud crabs, this was supposed to be called the crab, but because we're playing with the Skyrim mod, the names of these resources have been changed. These are now mud crabs. I'm surprised this is still called fish. It should have been called like something salmon or something, but yeah, overall it's fish. And yeah, so this is the unique unit. The unique ability, however, is the, let's check it out here. We're gonna go to the leader, Ueknik, I think his name is Ueknik. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing that correctly. Until the ice breaks, you will gain food from claimed snow, tundra, and ice tiles that are outside the city limits. So, you know, the city limits are like 3 tiles. if you go beyond these 3 tiles, I think that's what I understand, you will start gaining food bonus on that city, depending on which city has that extra border. And I'm not sure if that food bonus is actually pooled or is given to a specific city. Also, if every time you improve a fish resource next to snow, tundra, or ice, it will turn into a seal, which is a unique luxury for the Inuit, which is really cool. And it just will give you extra luxuries in the start of the game, which means you absolutely need to have some fish. And furthermore, after you improve that and you have a seal, you will gain a production, one-time production bonus or boost from that particular improvement. Now, what else do we have? Yeah, let's go. And finally, the unique improvement, which will this one is kind of complex. This will give you plus one food and culture all by itself, and it can only be built on snow and tundra. All right, so you know, standard. But what it can do as well is that all the tiles around it will gain plus one production and plus one food. So if you build this thing here, all of these will gain plus one food and plus one production. So you can see it is very potent, very powerful, depending on if you have a lot of resources. So if you and also it's incredibly good if you have a river with some kind of with tundra. Over tundra tiles, it is just incredible. You can build a river and tundra, you can build a farm anywhere on these, you will reach crazy levels of food and production. You can go all the way up to 3 food and 1 production without even without civil service, which will increase food from farm. You can go 3 food and 1 production without this one, and without even the fertilizer, which is much later on. So yeah, very potent, very powerful improvement, and we're going to try to maximize it. So you can see here that at the start of the game, we're going to try to spam as many of these Unaks and Inuks, or Inuksuks, which is the unique improvement. Yeah, it's a funny pronunciation, but that's how it works. So we're going to try and spam as many of them as possible, while at the same time, eventually, after we are done exploring, and we can acquire this technology here, which is the fish resource, I believe, yeah, which will allow us to improve fish, we'll go for sailing eventually. So it's going to be a lot of good time here. At the start of the game, we're going to have a lot of difficulties with research, obviously, because we don't have a lot of food. I mean, we barely have enough. And it's going to be very difficult to improve, given that our population is very low and our science is very low as well. I wonder why our science is so low to begin with. Let's check it out here. Yeah, science is 3 from buildings, 1 from population. Where is that? Maybe it's the palace. Yeah, so I think we have 3 signs from palace. All right. So supposedly, in normal, in other normal factions that don't have starting bites for snow, you would gain a new population in like 5 or maybe even 3 turns. But here it's more like 7. So it's going to take a long time for us to develop proper science income, which is made even more difficult by the fact that we need to rush for certain technologies such as this one. Look at this. It's going to take 19 turns, which is a very long time. So at the start of the game, it's going to be very challenging. And one of the things that we absolutely need is a proper pantheon. We absolutely need to found our religion. Otherwise, it's going to be, we need a religion that will either improve the yields from camps, provide us with plus one food from camps, or plus one production from these sea resources. And there are 2 camps. I think it's the goddess of the hunt or the god of the sea. So we need one of them in order to do well in this game. If we can acquire neither, then we're going to have a bit of a problem, because it means that... actually, we could go for any other pantheon, but if we can't find the pantheon, then we're pretty much going to be at a huge disadvantage. Alright, finally, we have some kind of Dwemer Ruin here. Yeah, look at this. It's called Dwemer Ruins. Dwemers are, of course, for those of you who are familiar with the with the Elder Scrolls mod, Dwemer are the dwarves, the ancient civilization of dwarves. If you played Skyrim, you will immediately know what they are. In fact, there's a unit you can build here, which you can acquire from the ironworking. There's an airship prototype, which is really cool. Unfortunately, it cannot be upgraded into anything, I think. Actually, it can be upgraded into an ironclad, which is nice. Although it's supposed to be some kind of flying unit. It's like a helicopter, and it also can move onto the ocean tiles. It can cross across the ocean, so it's a very excellent scouting unit, and you can build it very early as well. It takes 1 iron, and unfortunately we don't have a lot of iron when playing as these guys, the Inuit. On the other hand, we gain a bunch of culture there, which was going to help us along with the liberty. Since we are starting in a very wide space here, I'm most likely going to go for liberty. which means we can we have multiple locations in order to found new cities. And most likely my next city is going to be somewhere around here next to, I'm either going to go for the river or the mountain, and I prefer mountains, to be honest, because when we're playing as the Inuksuk, and when we're playing as the Inuit, we have the Inuksuk improvement, which means we can easily improve these towns without much need for the rivers. I mean, you could give them all plus one food, plus one production. It's going to be just excellent. So yeah, the mountains are actually more important, and we absolutely need that science, especially when you're playing as the Inuit. Alright, we go for the Liberty right away. Usually when I play as the Inuit and I find myself starting on an island all by myself, not connected to the rest of the land, it's incredibly difficult, because you're forced to go for tradition instead. And you know, with tradition, it's not very good for science victory, because you obviously can't build too many cities. Unless you manage to build a bunch of wonders, which we really can't. I mean, if you're going for tradition, you need a lot of food, you need a very high population, you need to build a bunch of improvements. You know what, now that we have some rice and maize and a bunch of deer here, actually this is going to be an excellent second location for our city. Yeah, we're going to go for this one actually, right there. Tundra surrounded by snow, excellent. It just looks perfectly thematic, you know. And I really like the overall design. Look at the peaceful nature of this landscape here. It's just pure white snow here and these harsh tundra locations. I just like it. I love it. I think it's very cute. And the fact that we are desperate, it creates this sense of desperation that you are constantly searching for resources wherever you can find them. Awesome, awesome. We have some whales here. This is going to be an excellent location. Although we might be forced to buy a couple of tiles in order to get the whales. Look at this. They're actually called Horkers, which is a monster from the Skyrim mod, from the game of Skyrim, and you know, the Elder Scrolls. Now there's a faith. There's a piece of faith here. There's this belief which you can acquire eventually called the Blood Horkers, which is it is the replacement for God of the Sea religion. There we go. Look at this. All of these religions are based on the names of the gods found in Skyrim and the Elder Scrolls. There's Akatosh, which is one of the gods. There's the Daedra. I'm not sure what. Yeah, these are mostly just names. There are no preset characteristics for them. Yeah, they're basically just replaced the names. The religion, the icons are basically the same. They didn't change. There's Talos. There's, you know, the ones. The Talos is the one which was supposed to be forbidden by the Aldemiri Dominion. I'm a bit of a Skyrim nerd sometimes. I really like the history behind them. Now there's the Benevolence of Mara plus one happiness. Yeah, they basically just replaced them. I'm not sure if they added a few things extra. All right, this is the Blood Horkers plus one production from fishing boats. This is the one we really want. And if not possible, we will go for Hearthstone Worship, which is the plus one food from camps. This is basically the replacement for God of the Hunt. That's it. And Hearthstone, by the way, is the god that is responsible for the quest line whereby you are supposed to, I think, hunt down a werewolf or something. You will be given a choice. You will be given a choice eventually as to become a werewolf yourself or not. Actually, I didn't mean to move in that direction, but it looks like I didn't have much of a choice. Alright, so I'm going to move there. Now, eventually, once we are done exploring, we might send this guy back in order to improve this crab. Or we will just simply pump out another Unak and improve them ourselves. So we have a lot of choices here. Now, this is a bit controversial. I'm going to go for the monuments at first, but eventually I do want to build the shrine. So once the shrine research is complete here, the pottery, I will add the shrine after the monument, and I will switch them so that I can focus on the shrine, because we really need some religion. Religion was going to really help us along. And furthermore, we are very far away from the other civilizations, so it's kind of difficult for us to adopt other people's religions. I don't think it's actually practical for us to do that. So yeah, this apparently we have this other continent there, so it might not be very practical for us to use this guy for exploration. We might actually want to get the Unak there in order to explore this area. And I'm actually going to send this warrior down into the tundra instead. Yeah, because these Unaks, they can explore the ice and they can explore the oceans. I mean, the snow is much better than the warrior. Now, the game is telling me that the animal husbandry is a good idea, but we're never going to be able to find horses. We're pretty much on the snow here, so it's not a good idea. Instead, I'm going to go for Tanning is a good idea, especially since we're going to be constructing a bunch of camps, and we do want that. And even better, the tannery here, which will give you plus 1 gold from each and every deer resource. So we're going to gain a bunch of gold if we build this thing. And it will give you plus 1 leather luxury, which we absolutely need. I'm not sure how lucky we're going to get. I mean, if I'm very close to rage quitting if the AI managed to get, like, both pantheons, the Bloodhawkers and the Hercene Worship. So we're going to be in big trouble if that doesn't happen. So I really want to switch it up into the shrine. There we go. Right, we're going to prioritize the shrine because we do want that religion. And it would have been really useful if we had some sort of production nearby, like some sort of forest or whatever, but it doesn't seem to be any right now. So the research, this is the part that's very confusing. Do we want to go for a library as soon as possible? I don't think so, because we're not going to be able to build that fast enough anyway, because, I mean, think about it, we don't have any production here, so building stuff too fast is just not useful. But, however, the cheapest thing we can build is the Unak, you can see here. Yeah, he is the cheapest thing we can build. Look, it only takes 9 turns. Everything else takes more than 10 turns. So if you want to spam these and start improving these resources, we might as well go for sailing, which is going to take only 15 turns. It's a bit too long. But then again, by then, the city will have been no longer occupied. Yeah, it will have finished the construction of the shrine. So I think that's a good choice. I'm pretty sure other more expert players than I am might disagree with me on this, but I've sort of played this multiple times, and I feel like this is the combination that works out for the best. Now we're going to move this warrior down. Yeah, we're going to continue to explore this area. There's so much potential for expansion here. But overall, I'm kind of worried that this area here might be occupied by someone else, by some other civilization. Like, especially if we come across Denmark or the Siberians, that would be a bit troubling, because they're somewhat warmongering, if you. And I'm pretty sure most of you are familiar with Denmark being in Civ 5, at least being a nation that you know, Harald Bluetooth is a bit of a warmonger in this game. Alright, so these guys have refined moonstone, which is basically porcelain. It's kind of funny. They have refined moonstone, whereas moonstone itself, I believe, was the... let's see, which one is these? It's moonstone. It should be somewhere around here. Moonstone. There it is. Marble is moonstone, whereas porcelain is refined moonstone. That's actually very clever. I like that idea. I'm not sure if porcelain is made of marble or not. I'm not really sure about that. It might be. Anyways, I don't think so. It's not. No, it's made of silica or some kind of material. That's it's related to silicates. Anyways, so it's nice to know that the encampment is very far away from us. But the thing about encampments on the snow is that they spawn barbarians at a ridiculously fast rate. They're incredibly fast when they come to spawning. And by the way, I'm actually very glad that we have this city-state right next to us, because we can eventually, if we run out of places to expand to, we can just conquer these guys. We can just take away their city, and, you know, it comes with a clay right next door, and there's a fish here. Hopefully there's some kind of ice tile down there, so we can turn this into a seal resource. I'm going to shove this guy here, just to see that deer. Okay, we can manage to spy that deer. We're going to embark this guy, this Unak, in order to explore the continent right next door. Yeah. But what I really need is some ruins. We actually desperately need some ruins that can give us extra faith. You know what? I'm actually going to postpone sending him to the next continent. We're going to search for ruins. And the reason why I'm sending him to the south here, into the tundra, is because ruins don't appear on the snow. It's very rare for them to appear there. In fact, I think they never appear on the snow. Alright, so the AI usually likes to go for Fusroda, which is the goddess of protection replacement. I don't know why, it's just something that the AI likes to do. And I'm glad for that, because this will give us the chance to grab the Bloodhawkers or even the Hercene Worship. In fact, I'm most likely going to go for the Bloodhawkers, because look at that. We're getting a lot of production, and we absolutely need that. It's a very good combo overall. Alright, so we're going to send you in this direction, and you down here. So we came across our first rival, apparently. Let's take a look. Who are these? Alright, so this is Nepal. They have a... I think they gain extra bonuses from mountains of some sort. I think that's what they... So they probably have, like, a starting bias next to mountains. I'm not sure, but it's probably the case. We could take a look at their history. Let's take a look. Civilizations. Nepal, where are you? Or Nepal, as we call it in Arabic. Where is it? There it is. Okay, so there's a bit of a glitch here. If you open the screen, you get this. The text has been superimposed over the entire screen, but you can read it if you want. It's somewhat readable, but I wouldn't use it, to be honest. So let's go for the Gurkha. Let's see. Yeah, this is much better. Yeah, the Gurkha gains a small amount of experience each turn. Okay, so they gain passive. They have a passive experience gain, and they have a bonus to. So that's it. Okay, so it has nothing to do with mountains, apparently. But we gotta check out the civilization again. Oh, that's much better. Rice terrace. How does this work, I wonder? I can't even scroll down, so I have no idea what this thing does. But it gives you plus one production. I think you can only build this on hills or something. It is similar to the Inca bonus. Alright, so there they are. I'm gonna try to find some kind of ruins here, but it doesn't appear to be any ruins anywhere. It's interesting. I'm actually gonna go to the west this time around, because we absolutely need those ruins. And I believe they have already explored the ruins next to them, so yeah, this location is just a no-go for us. Yeah, I might as well go back where I came from. We go for the Republic. We're going to try to pump out a settler as soon as we can. Unfortunately, we cannot build him here because, I mean, look at us, we have the terrible food. Although some expert players might tell you, you know, you should be doing the exact opposite. You should be pumping out a settler so that you can expand as fast as you can into areas with more food in them. Alright, so this location is unprofitable. We're going to go in that direction instead. Yeah. Do you want to complete this monument? I don't think it's very important. We should be building eunuchs instead. Yeah, let's go for the eunuch. We want to improve these sea resources as soon as we can. Oh, just want to switch them up. There we go. Yeah, getting some extra food and such is actually more important at the beginning. So you want that. We're going to move in this direction. So here's the plan. We're going to send the warrior towards the east across the snow, even though he is much slower moving. But because our scout can go across that continent, I am secretly hoping that we find some ruins, although we might not get so lucky. Alright, so they're going to be a little bit angry at me because I'm stepping through their territory. But who cares? So this city acquired the clay tile here, which means it's even more attractive if you want to capture it. But what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to go for this tile. Yeah, I'm actually going to try my best to grab this tile and just buy a bunch of tiles as much as I can in order to prevent Nepal from taking it away from us. Although, if you think about it, I don't think they have any interest in settling in this region because it's so much snow and tundra and they don't really have any bonuses in that direction. So we're kind of safe. We are safe. Come on, you can do it. Gonna try to pump out this guy. How much gold are we making anyway? We're making plus 3 gold. It's not much. I'm gonna try to move across these snow regions. I think there's a land bridge behind that. Alright. Do we still want to go for animal husbandry and go after the camp? It's a valid choice, by the way. We're gonna go after the calendar eventually, and finally the iron, I suppose. The iron sounds good. Yeah, sounds like a good choice so far, yeah. We want to reveal iron. Now, iron doesn't usually appear over the snow, right? So I don't want to do this because eventually if I want to exchange my embassies with this guy, he's going to ask me for gold in return. So I don't really like that. And I don't want to reveal my territory anyway. Yeah. So we have a barbarian, an early barbarian here, looks like. I'm going to try to go over the next continent and destroy some of them, but I feel like my scout might get his ass kicked. So there's no guarantee we might actually do well with this endeavor. On the other hand, we really need to explore this area. Just to see what other locations we might settle. And look at this, all of these fish, since they are all located right next to the snow and ice, they will all turn into seals. So we're going to have a bunch of seals in this game. And there goes another city-state, Malacca. Cool. another 30 gold. Could use that to buy stuff. Right now I only have 159, so it's not very much. But it's better than nothing. Hercene Worship, okay, so this one is out. Yeah, it is kind of starting to piss me off slightly. If we miss that chance, if we miss the chance to get the Bloodworkers, the game is over. And here's the thing, the game outright cheats against you. It will take away the one thing that you absolutely need. Alright, I'm gonna try to settle there. There's a sheep up there, which is nice. It's interesting, the Malacca hasn't actually targeted... Oh, they actually are targeting barbarians in general, but they're not targeting this encampment in particular. So I'm actually gonna leave it for later. I don't think we can afford to fight them right now. I'd much rather have this warrior closer to home, perhaps? I don't know. Yep, there's a barbarian. We might actually kill that thing. Yeah, let's try and kill him. There we go. We get a little bit of friendship with these guys, like some 15 points of friendship. I'm not sure. How much do we gain? How much did we gain from this? We gained like 12? Yeah, we gained like some 12 bonus. Alright, so this is going to be our first seal. There we go. It's actually going to appear next turn, I believe. Yeah, so this is the problem. We're not strong enough to take down these guys, so I'm actually going to embark again. It's easy to escape. You just enter the water immediately. Try and scout this region. Of course, they're going to try to follow me. Yeah, we're going to need a lot of faith before this happens. Okay, so we have our first seal. We have a bunch of extra happiness there. What do we want to build next time? We could go for the settler, but it takes a huge amount of time there. It's impractical. The eunuch is actually more practical. Or even the granary. Oh, screw it, let's go for the eunuch. I'm gonna heal this guy. There we go, an extra Dwemer ruin. I don't think anyone else will explore this. It's gonna be all mine. But of course, this barbarian is gonna attack me right away. And look at this, they're called Bandit Outlaws in this game because of the Skyrim mod. Okay, so I'm pretty much forced on the defensive. We're gonna have to fortify until healed. And I'm pretty sure they can take their. They can hold out. As long as this. Encampment doesn't spawn any crazy triremes or something, or galleys. We should be able to escape into the water in case they spawn something else. Yeah, barbarian encampments on the snow are crazy. Look at that, they already spawned this. Oh, man. Alright, so how am I gonna escape this situation? We could do this, and this, and then we can... Yeah, that is excellent. We get an extra population, which we really need at this point. Let's see, the citizen working, how are they working? Yeah, I'm pretty much forced to work on this extra food there. We don't have any choice. But yeah, there's a river right there, which means we can actually claim all of these tiles right away. We get an extra sheep and the clay, yeah, so this is another good location for eventually expanding. So it looks like we are going to miss out on these two fish. Yeah, it's a bit unfortunate. Unless there's an island hidden down there, which I don't think is true, because these are all oceans. Anyways, we're going to get attacked by these guys. We should probably escape somewhere. Ouch. It's a good thing there's a river between us, which means we get a slight defensive buff. I'm going to try to heal again. Actually, no. If these guys attack, they can pretty much kill me right away. I'm going to try to escape in this direction. The good news is, as long as they have too many units... Alright, so these are the Sami, which is another nation that has extra bonuses from Tundra. So the good news is, because they have so many land barbarians here, it means it is unlikely that they will spawn a ship. Which means we kind of got lucky there. We're going to go into the water right away. We're going to have a work boat there. How about a worker? How long does it take to... Oh, okay, we're very close to having the trapping technology, which means we should try to pump out another worker there. Yeah. Trying to think here, what could be possibly be a good location for expansion? We might go for this one actually, because these three fish, we're gonna miss them. We're gonna miss them completely. We're not gonna be able to acquire them. So is there a way for us to acquire 3 fish and an extra horker? No, doesn't look like it. Yeah, we're pretty much forced to go in this direction. Oh well. So these are the Sami, these are the Boazovazi. I have no idea what this thing is. It looks like a scout. I'm guessing it's a scout. Could be wrong though. I'm gonna try and check out this area just to see if there's any ruins whatsoever. There goes the barbarian. Man, so many barbarians. I'm gonna refuse the request for now. We don't have a lot of gold, but I'm not gonna sell you that. Actually, I might buy it from you. Alright, next time somebody suggests it to me, I might actually take that suggestion. Anyways. Now, this scout is in danger of dying of a horrible premature death, especially if there's some kind of galley spawns in this area. I hope we can make it in time before another galley spawns or something. So yeah, look at this landscape. It's a beautiful landscape, full of snow, but it's very challenging nonetheless. So we need like four extra faith before we can found our own religion, I believe. Come on. We can do it. Of course, founding our own pantheon does not guarantee founding our own religion. In order to do that, we need to build more cities and build a bunch of shrines. Alright, so there is no galley spawned. That is good. And there is nothing here for us. Okay. No resources. We haven't yet discovered iron, so it's not been revealed. Yeah, it's a bit of a long way off. But we will gain another policy in the next 2 turns. Let's take a look. We're definitely going to go for the collective rules so we can expand and acquire these horkers. Whew, we made it safely. Alright, so these guys are going to be used to escort them. The hell? Yeah, we're going to use these guys, the Unox, in order to escort the settler that's going to come out next turn. Although we do need to heal them first. Which is easier said than done. It's gonna take a while for them to heal. Yeah. Are there any fish around here? I'm not sure. Yes, we now have the ability to find the blood horkers. Although some of you might argue that forget the blood horkers. Why don't you just go for Dance of the Aurora, which will give you extra faith from these tundra tiles? The thing is, there's not gonna be a lot of. Actually, that's a good idea. Why don't we go for that? But there's not a lot of tundra here, it's mostly just plains, so it's going to be a very late improvement for us. Instead, we should go for something that gives us extra faith. Plus one faith from forest and jungle tiles, plus one food from pastures. We don't have any pastures anywhere, but we do have some jungles here. Some forests, like 3 forests, and that's it. No forests here whatsoever. Mist grove, plus one culture from jungle tiles. Yeah, it's just not much for us. Yeah, so far the only one that's looking pretty solid, I think, is the Bloodhorkers. Yeah, let's go for this one. Yeah. Give us the extra production that we need in order to, yeah, build this worker a little bit faster. Now we can pump out another settler. There we go. Now the cool thing about this guy is that he can move a little bit faster than the settlers. Which means he can heal. He can move forward. Somebody has founded, what's this? I have no idea what they found. Let's take a look. Beliefs. So we have, yeah, increased attack, plus one from, alright, so that's it. Somebody built a Stonehenge, which means they're going to found a religion very soon. Which is kind of unfortunate. Malakka is under attack by the barbarians, or in this case, the... Okay, so they actually took a worker, alright. Send this guy to heal for now. There we go. Do they have an archer which we can use to? Oh, okay, so they don't have an archer, they only have like the city. Ivavik demands soul gems, which is the replacement for diamonds, I think. Alright, so we want to settle right next to the river here. We're going to ignore the mountains for now. In fact, there is absolutely no chance for us to go next to the mountains. There are more rivers for us, indeed. I wonder if I should have settled right next to the lake, which will give us some lake improvements, like some gardens, perhaps? It's a valid point. Then again, if we settle there, we don't lose much. Anyways, gonna try to kill this guy. Alright, he's gonna be dead next turn, I think. So the Hercene worship would have been really useful for us. Look at this, we have a bunch of deer, plus one food from all these would have been very useful. Oh, there's an actual enemy nearby. The hell, where did these guys come from? Okay, so they came from the encampment there. I hope they can't plunder the... Yeah, if they can plunder the steels, we're in big trouble. In fact, one of my cities is outright starving. Ouch. Are you kidding me? They actually spawned... Oh, they actually switched places. Okay. I'm gonna try to move away. Alright, shall we do this? I think it's a good place, yeah. We have plains right next to us. We have a bunch of rices and... Although we are going to miss the Mammoth Tusk. You know, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to try to go for the Mammoth Tusk by settling here and eventually grabbing this. And if I want to get the Horkers, we can always just place an extra city right there. Yeah, we gain these two fish eventually. Yeah, we're gonna settle right there, right over this. We gain extra production from it, and we can immediately improve these. Once we have a worker, of course. Yeah, the Mammoth Tusk will give us a lot of happiness and a lot of gold as well. Good. I hope they don't come after me, because if they do, we're never gonna be able to free this poor worker. In fact, I'm actually gonna take this worker for myself, because we do need it. I don't wanna waste production on, you know, trying to build these workers and such. So I'm gonna take it. There we go. And we can use that worker to improve the city right away. So we're not making any gold whatsoever right now. Which is not good. I'm gonna go for the shrine right away. We're not found a religion as soon as we can. I hope this guy doesn't come after me. Alright, the Sami have plus one faith from forests and plus one from pastures, which is what they usually like to do. This is the pantheon they usually like to go for, and it gives them a lot of benefits. Yeah, look at that, plus one faith from all these forests all around them. Did these guys found their pantheon? I don't think so. But they sure have a lot of stuff. Look at that, glow dust and salt. Yeah, so much stuff. Once we start making some gold, we're actually going to try to buy the Mammoth Tusk before they found another city and try to grab it. What else can we do? I think it's about time we try to destroy that encampment or something. Oh man, these guys are back again. We're starving. We're losing population right now. That is not good. Not good at all. Yeah, we're losing food. I can't believe we're gonna have to buy a trireme or something. Yeah, we're gonna have to buy this shit. Dear Lord, alright. We're already losing gold. Yeah, we're losing gold, definitely. We're gonna start losing science as well if this keeps going. I've never had this happen to me. A trireme appearing right from turn 44 and just terrorizing and starving my city immediately. Yeah, this is one of the dangers of relying too much on these sea improvements. A single trireme appears, you're pretty much screwed. How much gold are we making? Yeah, we're not making any gold right now. Too bad. Gonna try to kill that silly trireme. Barbarian galley or whatever it is. You are gonna start proving these deers. So now we're pretty much forced to go after these... technologies that will increase our gold income, I suppose? What could we possibly go for? The Saltern is a good idea. Construct a road between our cities, perhaps? And we're gonna try to rush the currency. There is so much stuff we need desperately, but so little time. So little research. could build another Unag, I suppose, or even another granary. How many turns is it going to take to improve this? It's going to take 6 turns, because we want to build the tannery as soon as we can. So, you know what? Let's go for the Unag.